Hey there, Center for Spiritual Living, Palm Desert. Good morning, good Easter morning to all of you. Many of you know I'm Dr. Joe Hooper. I am the spiritual director here at the Center for Spiritual Living in Palm Desert. We're so very glad you're here. We've got a special Easter service to do for you today. It's unique. You're in my office, and this is my lighthouse, and maybe I could probably make some sort of reference to that later. But this is a unique situation we have this Easter. We're unable to congregate at the church, even to do the taping. So I'm doing this at home, and I'm so not used to having an empty room, or let alone doing this in the office. So we're really glad you're here. We've got some special music for you today. Charles is going to do a great meditation and prayer, and we have some special vocals. The first one is from Ricky Byers, so let's welcome Ricky Byers Beckwith.
Good morning, CSL Palm Desert. Good morning, Reverend Joe Hooper and all my friends at CSL Palm Desert. Hey, I love you guys, and I want to sing a song for you to start the day off the right way. Come on, Trey, you can join in too.
Ricky, it was great to see her. Next up, we have announcements. We do have some announcements for you today. First off, I want to thank everyone who has been supporting the Center for Spiritual Living Palm Desert, writing checks, sending money in via text, just supporting us financially. This is a very difficult time, obviously, for centers and churches worldwide, and we so appreciate every single penny that comes into the center. So please continue to support us. We are so very grateful. On that note, we want to let you know what we're doing this week. First off, on Monday, I'm going to be going back in time in January, taking out the first four chapters of The Science of Mind. And I want to, we'll run that particular lesson, and then I will join on for a question and answer afterwards. So that's everything that happens this week happens at 10 o'clock. The first one is Science of Mind 101, Chapter 1, The Thing Itself. We'll be doing that Monday morning at 10 o'clock. Then on Tuesday, join Charles, Reverend Charles, and myself as we do a conversation with Dr. Joe and Reverend Charles. And you never know, we might sneak in a special guest like we did last week with Dale Alansky. That was really special for us. On Wednesday, we have a very special presentation by all the ministerial students. At 10 o'clock in the morning, all six of our ministerial students will be getting online. Please join them Wednesday at 10 o'clock. On Thursday, we have two events, two very special events. Gary Lynn Floyd and I will be doing a concert and conversation like I did with Karen Drucker and Levi a couple weeks ago. So we'll do that at 10 o'clock in the morning. Reverend Laura, 10 Secrets to Success and Inner Peace. That's Laura's 10 Secrets to Success and Inner Peace. Gary's at 10 o'clock, Laura's at 2. Then on Friday, I'm going to do the second chapter of The Science of Mind, The Way It Works. Then on Saturday, we'll have a meditation from one of our ministers. So that's what we have going on this week. Please continue to log in. Please continue to joyfully and joyously and generously support us. I know some people, times are tough, but other people could please continue to support us. We greatly appreciate it so we can continue doing what we do. So next up is Charles with the mission statement and our meditation.
All right, Center for Spiritual Living, Palm Desert. It's a good day. Let's join together in saying our mission statement, shall we? Here we go. We are a dynamic, open, and positive faith community that accepts all religions. Our mission is to awaken you to your divine nature, empowering you to create the life of your dreams. We are changing lives, one heart at a time. All right, our beautiful community, let's take this moment and enter into our sacred time of meditation on this beautiful Easter Sunday. And gather ourselves into this idea of rebirth, of being resurrected in a new consciousness this morning. So join me by turning your attention inward and let's take a deep breath. And as we enter into this time of meditation, consider this question for a moment. What am I willing to be resurrected into today? What am I willing, what a new and glorious blessing am I willing to welcome into my life that from this day forward, I am forever changed? That from this day forward, I am made new from within. The Christ consciousness that is all around, that is in, through, and as all of life, that it be in me now, consciously aware of it, remolding me and remaking me from within, that I am forever changed, that I die to the old and am birthed into a new and glorious dawn of my life, that I see with new eyes and hear with new ears. So as we move through this time of sacred meditation, this ritual that we share together every week, let the music, the prayer, the collective Christ consciousness wash over us and renew us from within, that we are forever changed. Amen. The name and the nature and the glory of God.
In the silence there is unspoken joy. In the silence there's release from a world full of chaos and noise. So I awake in this holy silence. I hear all that has never been said, and right here in this holy silence we find God, when we find ourselves. In the silence there is peace. In the silence there is unspoken joy. In the silence there's release from a world full of chaos and noise. So we awake in this holy silence. We hear all that needs to be said, and right here in this holy silence we find God, when we find ourselves. And I find God when I find myself. And you find God when you find yourself.
I'm grateful to know this morning that there is one power and one presence, the living Spirit of God Almighty, called by many names, but the force of which remains changeless. It is life. It is the life that I am living now. It is the life that each one of us are living on this glorious Easter Sunday. And I know that because we live inside of this presence, that we are made new now. That a sacred intention lands gently on our hearts, that remakes us, that allows us to fly in new ways, ways we haven't flown before, that we're blessed with new ideas and new awakenings. We're blessed with a sunrise every moment of our lives, a fresh insight about our spiritual magnificence, a revolution of our soul, a revolution of our mind, a revolution of our heart that ushers us into a new era of being, a new era of consciousness, fresh belief, fresh attitudes, fresh ideas, freshness all around. And that we are blessed by it, that we are anointed today by the Christ presence that is risen into the heaven of our own being. That we see new, that we feel new. That our heart perceives in fresh new ways. I know that we are blessed today. I'm grateful for this word and for the unfolding of this service, for the way that it blesses each one of us, for the ways that we are changed forever because of the words of Dr. Joe, because of the powerful music that we experience, and because of our collective connection, that we are always connected in mind and in heart. And for this today, we are supremely blessed. I am grateful. I know that the word that I am speaking is powerful because it is the only authority from which it comes is the presence and the power and love of God. I'm grateful for this. I simply let it be, knowing that good is at hand. I call it good. And together we say, and so it is. Amen.
Let's sing this song together.
We are one, we are one. I am you, you are me, we are one. And in this unity, we can live in harmony, and peace has come. 'Cause we are one, we are one, we are one. I am you, you are me, we are one.
We're gonna slow it down right here.
And And in this unity, we can live in harmony. And peace has come, 'cause we are one.
One more time, let's sing it out.
We are one, we are one. I am you, you are me, we are one. And in this unity, we can live in harmony. And peace has come, 'cause we are one. And peace has come, 'cause we are one.
Song was by Doug and Megan. You know them. They're always at our center. They just do a magnificent job. So now let's talk about our Easter service. What an unusual time to be celebrating Easter. Many people are feeling like their homes have sort of become, not in not a literal way, but very much like the tomb, very isolated. And this is a challenging time to go through an Easter holiday when we're so used to having a sanctuary filled with lilies and this energy and the excitement and the music and the flowers outside everywhere where you drive around and community is buzzing with all this activity. It's sort of different to feel the way we are this today in this moment on Easter Sunday. But I want to make the best of it. And I do want to tell you that, and I've said this before, and I'll say it again, we will be doing an Easter service, an Easter celebration, a resurrection service, the first Sunday we are able to gather together in the sanctuary. So this is my Easter message, but it's an Easter light message because the powerhouse one, the one where we're all going to feel it and be together in a room, that's going to happen this first Sunday we get together. So let's talk about Easter. Many of you will see the picture. In fact, hopefully it's coming back up on the screen. This is the image of Jesus, the master teacher that I relate to. And I bring this picture up every year, and I have for 20 years, and as many years as I will do an Easter service, that will always be my guiding picture as I move through Easter Sunday. That picture reminds me of someone that I could have a conversation with, someone I could relate to, Jesus the man. Not the one that I see with the halo around it and the just that whole feeling of being so transcendent beyond the human form. I like looking at what I believe would be Jesus, the man, and listening to what he taught. So today I want to go through some of that with this Easter Sunday in mind. Excuse me. First off, Jesus, the master teacher, said, I have shown you the way. I have shown you the way. He set the example up, especially if you read any of the four Gospels. You'll see that the message of love has shown the way through his teaching. So he says, I've shown you the way. And now what I want to say is, now let's do it. It's one thing to show me the way. It's another thing to teach me something. But you don't know what you've been taught until you put it into action. So let's talk about how Jesus put his actions into play at the time so that it created for us a message and a model that we can use in this particular situation and in the world in general. So first off, what does Easter represent? What does Jesus, the master teacher, Easter represent? Dr. Holmes said this, Easter does not represent the passing into death and return. It represents the power and the strength to go beyond the end of things to a new awareness and a new vision. So Easter doesn't represent the passing from into death and return. It, in a metaphysical way, and in the larger picture, tells us that we can gain a new awareness by going beyond the end of things. So let's set that in context. First off, in context, we have the end of something happening. I don't know about you, but I certainly feel like in this point in time in my personal history, in the middle of April in 2020, there has been an ending to something that I've always taken for granted. And that is, I've always taken for granted being able to converse with people face to face, or to hug someone, or to touch someone, or to, you know, go out to dinner. All those things that we all took for granted have now changed. And it's I don't think it's the end of it. It certainly is a hard stop to it though for a while. And I think during that hard stop, there's a lesson to say, okay, there is a temporary death, if you will, a stop of something. And now what's going to become of this resurrected experience? How will we be when this is over? How will I be? How will I appreciate the things that I have in my life when all of this is over? And I think that's part of the teaching, because it's going to bring us into a new awareness. I think if anything, Jesus, the master teacher, taught us. He taught us that we are constantly moving into a new awareness. And because of that, I want to know that in this process that we're in right here and right now, this is sort of like our Good Friday, our time in the tomb, our time to reevaluate what we believe to be important in our life. And when we transcend and resurrect out of this experience, we will have a new life. Now, it may not be the life we had before, but I also think that there are things that are going to be greatly magnified out of gratitude because of that. So things will turn back to normal. Things will turn back to what I hope is an old normal. I hope it's a new normal that has this attachment to this new awareness that we have as we resurrect through this experience. Now, hopefully there's a picture of a cross going to come up behind me, a graphic of a cross. And so we look at the cross at Easter time. Dr. Holmes said this: the cross, the suffering, the anguish, and the tomb were but preliminary incidents to the resurrection, to the triumph of the Spirit. So as we know, on Easter, on Good Friday, between Good Friday, you know, when Jesus was crucified, to the time he rose from the dead, we know those that the cross represented that. But the cross, I think, could also represent something different for us. I like the graphic of the cross from showing the light going from the very top all the way down to the bottom, because in the sign of the cross, the infinite into the finite, the energy of the infinite God moving into the finite being, which is you and I. We are not infinite, we're finite. But the universe, infinite to finite, and then the horizontal line represents through all things, through all humanity, through the entire universe, the infinite to the finite covering everything. That's a very powerful statement. Now, you don't have to be a Christian, or you don't have to be a Jew, or you don't have to be any religion to understand that there's a power that affects us, that affects all people. It happens to come out as the sign of a cross, but I don't think that was ever the intent of that symbology, but we can use it as that. That there's the infinite moving into the finite, and it impacts everyone. And the certainty of the cross cannot long crucify, nor the tomb long contain that which is destined to live forever. So the cross can no longer bear its old connotation. It can't bear its old labeling. It has to be based on something that continues to live in our consciousness and in our universe, our culture. And it's, again, it's not a Christian thing. It's not a Jewish thing. It's not a Muslim thing. It's just a thing saying this idea of the cross, it hits all cross sections of all cultures, because it's just the infinite becoming known in the finite and for all people. And it can't contain itself in any label. It can't contain itself in any religion. It's just an example of how this energy can spread and is spreading. The energy of love has always been from God's love to our love, my love to everyone's love. How does that sound? Does that work? Next thing. When Jesus was going through the experience of the crucifixion, he conveyed there was a calm assurance. There wasn't a panic there. And I think that part of what he displayed was a calm assurance and an inner knowingness that what he set out to accomplish, he had accomplished, and he was willing to let it go. How can I take that lesson? How can I take that lesson? If Jesus can convey a calm assurance and an inner knowingness in such a trial and tribulation, that sets him up as a role model, an example to me to be able to do the same thing. That in crisis situations, I have to be able to sit back, exercise a lot of forgiveness. What did he say? Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Exercise a lot of forgiveness. This is the example of Easter. The resurrection was that he went through a very traumatic experience, but he also forgave, and he allowed there to be a calm assurance and knowing that whatever was happening was happening, and it was accomplished, already known in the mind of God, making itself literally a reality of the moment. That's what I think is happening to us. I want to be able to use that as a role model for myself, to have that calm assurance that as I walk through this process, that I will be more accomplished as a result of walking through this. To me, that's also a lesson of this Easter story. I want to have the calm assurance, knowing full well that whatever is meant to be accomplished by this and bringing people together and unifying them and seeing our oneness with people, that could be the result of this. I don't know what that is, but let's take that Easter example and Jesus, the master teacher, the example of the man, of what he did, and say, I'm going to enter this day and enter this experience with calm assurance, knowing that the right thing is being accomplished. What a great gift. Next, this. another thing that he taught us, teaching us that we should never forget the real nature of God. In this experience that we're moving through now, and I keep bringing it up because it's so prominent in our thinking and in what we're doing, there is an opportunity to see the nature of God in people and in ourselves. Number one, the nature of God is always loving and caring. And what have we been told to do during this process? We've been told, love and care for yourself so that you're able to love and care for others so that you don't subject them to illness. So take care of yourself so others can take care of themselves and be loving and caring in the process. And then we see these frontline responders and the medical profession and the store workers and everybody, you know what? There we are seeing the real nature of God, their givingness to itself. I mean, that is a perfect Easter lesson. The lesson is that we don't forget the real nature of God, that in times of crisis, that in times of difficulty, there is something within us that love for ourselves, a love for, and that translates as love for other people, as we respect what we need to do to allow this current situation to pass through. But then we also see the nature of God and the way people are taking care of one another. I see it all over social media. If someone has lost their job, if someone is hungry, please don't go to bed hungry. Please don't go to bed, you know, distressed. I will get food to you. Somehow I will get some food to you. I want, you know, what a great example of what the Jesus the teacher taught us. He doesn't want people to go hungry. I love that idea that there are people out in the community that are saying, I will do, in our center, there we have volunteers saying, we will do whatever we can within the guidelines of, you know, the community and the county to do whatever we can to assist you. We're doing the work in the nature of, in the name of God. Next thing, Jesus did not perform miracles that transcended natural law. No, Jesus realized he was using a higher law that each one of us have and can have that same realization. Jesus didn't perform the miracles. People call them that, but they were demonstrations of faith. That's what we call all of our demonstrations. Anything that we demonstrate, we can call it a miracle and then it becomes an exception, or we can call it using this higher natural law and we can have that same realization and manifestation that Jesus the teacher, I am myself can do nothing, it's the Father within that does the work, and you can do this too, is what he said. So to me, when we look at Jesus and this whole concept of Easter and this paradigm that we're in right now, which feels crazy at times, we can realize that we can transcend what is happening on the outside and have a higher vision for ourselves and realize that. The interesting thing about Jesus, the teacher, is that his method was very direct, it was dynamic, it was powerful, and yet it was really simple and easy to understand. There was no hocus pocus. There was no difficult equation, or there wasn't any tricks to his ministry. He was very simple, he was very direct. You know, what do you say to the guy laying on the bed? He's, get up from the bed and walk. Just get up in the bed and walk. Believe that you can and you will. And he empowered people to do that. And what in the end, when you think about it, what did Jesus convey? He was able to heal himself because he was able to heal others because he first healed himself. That's part of the Easter story. He was able to affect others because he was able to heal himself of his doubts, of his anger, of the disparity that he saw within his own community. He had to heal himself of those feelings so that he was able to be the spiritual leader of his time. And anyone with that message would have been exalted and been considered the King of Kings, because he would have been giving us a message that was so profound that would allow us to heal ourselves and heal other people. Who doesn't want to hear that even today in 2020? It's unbelievable. Continuing on. He was able to direct others because he had first received direction from the God within. He didn't do this by saying to people, do this because I'm telling you to do it. No, he had lived it. He had lived his gospel. He had lived his truth. And through example, he was able to bring people into the fold and they could see how this could work. He was able to direct others because he had received that direction for himself first. First and foremost, that's always our goal, is to receive the direction first and then to be able to live it in such a way that the kingdom of God becomes your kingdom. Finally, he was able to tell others about the kingdom of God because he lived in it, as it. He was able to share his story. He was able to share his wealth of information and his knowledge and wisdom of this truth, of this love, of this unconditional love, because he, not only had he learned about it, he embodied it, and he was living it. Think about the example that he would teach people through his actions. And you've heard me talk about this before. It happens on every Easter. Jesus hung out with the people that most people would reject in society. That's who he wanted to be with. He wanted to minister to those people who needed it most. If you think about that, and you really think about that, that is what we can do in our own society, in our own community. Let us not forget that it was more of just, it's more of a lesson. It's more than just a lesson in a book or in a talk. It is actually the ministry unfolding in this powerful way by us doing the things that he did. And you don't have to call your, look, when Jesus was crucified, he was a Jew. He was a Jew. He didn't know, if Jesus came down and we went out for a beer, I would say, hey, what does it feel like to be a Christian? And he wouldn't know what that would mean because he was a Jewish rabbi. So it transcends religions. This idea transcends religions. This man was a Jew, and his story as a Jewish rabbi, that's what we read in the Bible. Now, we call it Christianity, and some people have labeled that Christianity, but the reality is this was a Jewish man who gave us a great message. So it transcends the labels of religion. Let's just see it for what it is. This is a man who knew what he was doing. He lived within the kingdom because he had learned what the kingdom meant. The universe, or the God within him spoke and empowered him at such a level that he was able to transcend physical conditions and social lines. And he moved into a society in which he became part of a healing fabric. That's what we can become as well. We can do everything that he did, we can do if we choose to. And you know, one of the things that he said, it is finished, yet too it is just the beginning. In one of the Gospels, it says that. It is finished, and yet too it's just the beginning. Isn't that the truth? Isn't that the truth? I think that's it, yeah. When that was said in context, and it was, I forget which version of the Bible I read that out of, I questioned it because it's finished, but yet it's just the beginning. And when I read that and I hear that and I try to embody that idea, I have to understand that things like the resurrection that take place, things of the past that we let go, things that we roll away the rock and move into a new expression, when we have those things in our life, they feel like endings, but they're really not. They're endings that are actually beginnings. And today we celebrate a man whose ending in the physical body became a beginning of a spiritual and religious revolution that has changed cultures forever. And we celebrate that today. We celebrate because today we celebrate our brother, our teacher, the mortal man, and the spiritual being. This Easter Sunday is about celebrating all of those things, transcending out of the conditions of the tomb and Good Friday and the crucifixion into the resurrection, into the uplifting of our lives. Remember the cross from the finite to infinite to the finite, and it affects all people. That's the sign of the cross. Let's allow ourselves to be the expression of that infinite intelligence, that infinite love within our own hearts, and let's spread the message the way Jesus, the master teacher, the great example, spread his message. This is my message for you today. That was my message for you today. Let's allow ourselves to celebrate this Easter, even though we may be confined into our homes. Let's allow ourselves to strengthen within, see the lesson of transcendence, transformation, and allow ourselves to move into whatever this next day is, or the next week, or the next month, or the next year, whatever that is. We move in with a renewed sense of self. We renew in with a renewed sense of self that allows us to be direct, to be dynamic, to be powerful, and to make it extremely easy in our approach to life and recognize all the gifts that we have been given and not take anything for granted, but to treat other people with love, to treat other people with respect, to recognize our unity and oneness with all people. These are the messages that I glean from Jesus the teacher, that man, put the figure back up again. That man right there is someone I can identify with, someone I can relate to, and someone I would listen to as he would gently tell me the stories of love and compassion and how to be a better Joe in this life and how to be a better you in this life. For this is the life that we're living right now. This is our opportunity to recalibrate what is important to us and move into a greater expression on the other side of this. For this, we're so very grateful and so in your lesson. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Joe. What a beautiful Easter sermon. Aren't we blessed with his spiritual leadership? We're so, so grateful. So let's move into our time of sacred giving, our offertory, where we get to circulate our financial good in order to support ourselves, support this ministry, and really powerfully participate in the law of circulation today to give and simultaneously receive. As we're receiving the blessing, surely we want to give, and we just keep participating in that cycle over and over again. So join me as you virtually consider what your gift is, if you're an auto tithe, or are making your donation online today or texting in. Just consider not necessarily a number, but an attitude. The attitude of gratitude. And how each one of us are blessed this morning by the sacred message, the music, the good that we experience. And as we freely receive, let us freely give and participate in this great law of circulation, knowing that we continue to be blessed. And as we give, we automatically extend our hands in the direction of being willing to receive more as well. I'm grateful for this time of sharing. I bless us all and call it good, and so it is. Amen.
And so, on this Easter Sunday, I'd like you to close your eyes, take a deep breath in, and join me right now as we roll away the rocks of this current reality, and we seize within each other in our own minds this opportunity to transcend into something greater. In order to transcend to that better life, we must know and cling to this emotional idea that the universe, that God, that Jesus, the master teacher who taught us of this unconditional love, continues to call us into service that way. The tomb, we now leave this tomb, and it's an empty experience of the past, knowing that it's all already complete, and we move into this own resilience and this own proof of our own resurrection, our own opportunity to become renewed in this faith, to become renewed in this idea that love is always and shall always be the answer. That this incredible expression of life in human form, Jesus of Nazareth, the master teacher, we are so very grateful for the teachings that allow us to move into a greater expression of love and oneness with all people. And we take this lesson as our own today, knowing that violence is not the answer. War is not the answer. What the answer is, the answer always, always, always will return to love and unconditional love and healing and the presence of God within, which are all things that we have been taught by the master teacher. So we embody that idea right now. We know that we don't have to force anything to happen, but use the example of Jesus the teacher who allowed, who surrendered, and who allowed things to move through him with grace and ease. With great elegance, with great compassion, and the greatest of all, love, love, and more love. As we move into the rest of this day and to this week, we become open and receptive to that which we needed to hear today, that which removed us from that place of loneliness into a place of recognition of that ever-present God love. That love of God expressing by means of you, expressing by means of me, because it is who we are. And that is a lesson that we can learn and glean from that master teacher Jesus, that there is only but one thing that is the answer to all things. And it's not something that's the exception, it's the rule. It's the rule and the law of the universe, and that's love. For this love and for this experience and for everything that we've had to experience today, we say thank you, beloved presence. Thank you, beloved presence. And so it is. And so it is. Happy Easter, everyone. We'll see you tomorrow, 10 o'clock. Everything happens at 10 o'clock. Have a great day.